What is up, dance teachers of the world? Welcome to the Dance Teacher Life. My name is Lucy. I'm a dance teacher and a dance team coach, and I've been teaching and coaching for the last 16 years. So on today's episode, we're going to be talking about knowing when you suck. And for some of us, that is a daily thing that we kind of have going through our head all the time. Because if you're anything like me, you're always sitting back and wondering, how can I make this routine better? How can I teach these kids all of these new things that they really need to learn to set them above the bar from everything else? What do I need to do to make these competition routines a flawless masterpiece? And I know that a lot of us at the end of the day have all of these questions running through our head constantly. So the first thing that we need to do is admit the fact that we suck sometimes, and that's okay. Once you're really comfortable with that idea of not being perfect, then you can start to take those really positive steps to improving your life as a dance teacher. So I'm going to give you my top 5 tips on what to do when you feel like you really suck as a teacher. Tip number 1, be okay with the fact that you are not a perfect dance teacher. You're going to make mistakes. You're going to question what you do sometimes. You just have to really take a step back and be okay with the fact that you're not perfect. You have to know when to admit to yourself, okay, this isn't perfect, this isn't great, I really need to take a step back and figure out what I'm doing. Now, a lot of this comes with time. The more you become comfortable in your dance career, the more you can really sit back and say, okay, like this isn't perfect. Let me try to work and try to fix these things. Now, my new teachers out there, it is going to take you a little bit before you kind of really start to build your own career path of what kind of teacher you want to be. I know that whenever I first started teaching dance, a lot of the things that I went through my head was, okay, these were all the really great things that I had experienced from previous dance team coaches or dance teachers in the past, and how am I going to implement that into my career path as a teacher? So a lot of my more experienced teachers are not even really willing to step back and admit the fact that you suck sometimes, because you feel like because you've been doing this for such a long time that you really have it all figured out. And that is another really big issue that I think that a lot of teachers have nowadays. You think, okay, well, I've been doing this for 20 years and I have it down packed and I don't need to change anything. Well, honey, I'm sorry, but you're wrong. The stuff that we were doing 20 years ago definitely is not the same things that we are doing nowadays. I mean, let's face it, 20 years ago, the main 3 styles were tap, jazz, and ballet. That was all, anything that you wanted to learn, it was those 3 things. So if you are not keeping up with what the dance world's doing nowadays, then again, you need to kind of take a step back and realize, okay, like maybe this is what I'm sucking at. So let me go and fix this. Number 3, continue your own dance education. The better you can stay educated, the better you will be able to educate your dancers. Make sure that you're staying on top of what's new and what's trendy and what the new skills are with the dance world. The absolute best way to do this is through social media. That is basically what the world revolves around right now anyway, so go and do your research. What are the new popular moves and skills and all that kind of stuff, and look at that and implement that into your classroom. Figure out how to teach these skills. Figure out what it takes to be able to do a lot of these skills. There are always going to be trends that come and go with popularity as, you know, the competitive world goes on. 5 years ago, it was turns. Everybody wanted turns. They wanted dancers to be able to do 30 rotations in their turns in seconds. Well, now that's not so popular anymore. Now it's all about legs and extensions and flexibility and showing off that control that a lot of dancers have. So if you are better, or if you are educating yourself on what is new and what's popular and how to teach and train your dancers with all these new things, the better advantage your dancers are gonna have whenever they go into competition, because they're already going to be doing what's new and what's trendy and what's popular, and they're also going to be doing what the judges want to see, which is going to make their score go up higher. There's really nothing worse than coming in and seeing a whole studio or a dance team that's stuck 10 years in the past. That stuff has already been done. Nobody wants to see it over again. So make sure that you really are keeping up with all of these things so that you can teach your dancers about what's going on. Also, whenever you're learning these new things, make sure that you're also learning how to teach them in the proper way. I know that acro is a super big, super popular thing right now. You need to make sure that you have a very solid dance education on how to spot for acro tricks, because if you don't, then your dancer is going to get hurt, or you're going to get hurt, and then you will be liable for all that kind of stuff. Acrobatics Arts is a really, really great website that you can go to. You can become certified with them. They have classes that you can take that are in-person classes. They will physically teach you how to spot and all that kind of stuff. So if you have never taught acro before or tumbling or any of that kind of stuff, make sure that you are doing your best to get educated on the safe way to do a lot of these things. Now, I do know that accidents are going to happen in general. That's something that really can't be avoided. But the better that you can prepare yourself and educate yourself, the better you can educate your dancers as well. Tip number 4, add structure to your life. Make sure that you are lesson planning for every single class that you have. If you lesson plan ahead of time, it's going to give you a point of reference to use whenever you come into class to say, okay, today we're going to get this done. If you have never lesson planned before, you really are going to need to pre-plan some time out in your day or throughout the week where you can sit down and really write out all of these lesson plans. Once you have the base of lesson plans kind of figured out of what you want to do, then you can use it as a general gauge for every lesson plan that follows. So your first lesson planning session is probably going to take a whole lot longer than your average weekly sessions that you do. So I set out at least once a week where I can do an hour to 2 hours that I can lesson plan for that entire week at a time. The reason why it takes me an hour is because I teach at the studio 5 days a week, and I also lesson plan in that both my dance teams. So that's kind of why it takes me a little bit longer. Some teachers, it may only take you 15 minutes because all you're going to do is set highlight goals, you know, that you want to get done for your classes that you have that week. If you're lesson planning for choreography, it's a little bit different when you lesson plan for that, because the majority of the time you're going to say, okay, I need to get this accomplished in this class, so I'm going to say I need to get 30 seconds of choreography done every single week by whatever week. Now, that's just a general gauge. Some of your classes, you're going to be able to knock out a minute of choreography within the first week that you meet with them. Others, it's going to take them a really long time to get a good grasp of what they're doing with that routine, so it may take you a little bit longer to get through that choreography. When you're lesson planning for choreography, you need to make sure that you are sending a list of technical skills to your technique teacher if you are not the dancer's technique teacher. Make sure that you are sending, okay, this is the list that I need them to really get and really perfect in the technique classes. That way you're not having to spend your choreography time teaching new skills. You'll get so, so, so much more accomplished. That is not to say that you don't need to teach new skills during your choreography sessions, but you don't need to spend the majority of your choreography time teaching new skills, because that's what technique classes and stuff are for. If you don't have technique classes set up with your dance studio, then you are going to need to pre-plan time for your dancers to learn the technical skills that you're going to need for this routine. If you're an acrobatics teacher, you need to make sure that you are allowing every single class to come in and have an adequate stretch and warm-up time. That is going to prevent your dancers from getting senseless injuries. You also need to make sure that you are planning realistic skills for your dancers to get within X amount of time. So, for instance, if you are an acro teacher and you only have a group of kids that can barely do a cartwheel, in a month, your kids are not going to be learning back handsprings. You have to make sure that they are learning the basics properly before you throw them into all these new advanced skills. That also goes back with technique too. make sure that you are spending adequate enough time on the basics and on the proper way to do things before you throw these kids into learning much more advanced skills. Because if you are pushing them into stuff way too quickly, then you are going to get these really silly mistakes that are going to start happening, that are going to continue to happen because that education was not properly done with all of those skills. So save yourself some heartache and grief and just kind of swallow that hard pill and say, all right, these kids need more time to learn these skills, and that's okay. But make sure that you are really going by those lesson plans. It will help so much whenever you even step foot into that studio or onto your dance team, because you know that you have this to get accomplished that day. So if you have had a really bad day, or if your brain is just not super focused in on class, you have that reference point to use to say, okay, this is what we're gonna get done, and it's gonna make sure that you stay on task, and then it's gonna make sure that your dancers stay on task, which is super great for everybody. Number five, and this is the biggest one. You have to know when to ask for help. You have to know your limitations as a teacher and as a coach. If you are a studio owner, you do not need to feel like you have to be perfect at every aspect of being a dance teacher. You can hire in the staff members that will help basically fill in the gaps for the stuff that you're not good at. You don't have to be the world's best choreographer. You don't have to be the world's best technique teacher at the same time. You can perfect your craft in the areas that you are really good at and hire in for everything else. You can also continue that dance education if you really feel like it's something that you're interested in learning how to do. But the biggest thing is that you don't have to choreograph every single style of dance if you're not good at it. So if you have a dancer, like if I have a dancer that's gonna come in and let's just say she's in high school, she's a level 3 dancer with lyrical. I know that coming in when that dancer says that she wants a routine with that style, I'm not going to be able to give her what she is wanting or a good enough routine that's gonna place well. So I'm gonna swallow my pride and I'm gonna ask for help. I'm gonna either reach out to another teacher at the studio to help with choreography. So I may have them do all of the choreography, or I may have them assist me with choreography, or I just may hire in for another choreographer that I want to come in from a different studio or from a different company and just flat out do the choreography. You don't need to feel bad about not choreographing every single routine for every single dancer you have at your studio. Some of our studios, it's impossible. There's no way that you could get all of that stuff done. And with dance teams, there are going to be certain choreographers that excel in certain styles that you may not be that great at. And that's okay to hire them in too. There is nothing worse than going in to competition and seeing these kids that it's blatant that their teachers just had absolutely no idea what they're doing, especially with soloists, because soloist parents spend an ungodly amount of money, you know, for those entry fees and that costume and, you know, the travel expenses that are associated with it. It's okay to admit that these parents, okay, I'm not going to choreograph this routine because I don't feel like I could do the best job possible, but I am going to clean your child solo every single week. And I feel like teachers too often don't want to admit that because they're way too prideful. So then they go in and they say, okay, I can do this and I'm gonna do this, when they basically know that these routines are crap. So they're actually hindering those dancers by not allowing them to learn from other dancers. Your dancers are never gonna grow if your education is limited or if your styles are limited. I tell my dancers all the time, I want them to outgrow me. I want them to be better than me because I am not their only teacher. So whenever I'm teaching them or teaching them choreography, I'm gonna come in and I'm gonna take all of the knowledge that I have and I'm gonna put it in their brain. And then whenever they go to their next class, that teacher is gonna take all of that knowledge and put it into their brain. So by the time that they finish with their dance career or whenever they graduate from high school, they should know more than one individual teacher at the studio. that means that you did a really amazing job with teaching them everything that they need to be taught. So know when to ask for help and be okay with the fact that you can ask for help. You can seek out these choreographers. You can hire in technique. You can hire in for anything that you need to do. At the end of the day, that is still your dance team or your dance studio. And you have to make sure that you are doing the best job that you can to set them up for success. They're not going to be successful if you pretend like you're perfect at everything. All right, guys, that wraps it up for another amazing episode of The Dance Teacher Life. Please make sure that you like and subscribe to this channel. If you have any questions or comments, feel free to drop them below and I'll do my absolute best to read and respond back to those. If you also have any suggestions for more episodes that you would like to see, definitely let us know. Thanks for watching!